So due to pressures of work and family, I haven't been able to record with Mark this week. However, I did manage to catch up with Clive Bailey of Mabel Greer's Toy Shop to discuss their new album, which features Yes legend Peter Banks on one song. Here's how that conversation went. Okay, I'm very, very pleased indeed to welcome back Clive Bailey of Mabel Greer's Toy Shop onto the show. Hello, Clive.
Hi there. Hello, everyone.
Great to have you back. Now, last time you were on the Yes Music podcast, you just released New Way of Life. So that must seem like a long time ago. It's been very busy and a successful time for you since then. What's been going on?
Well, we've been writing the second and recording the second album. So we did a couple of small gigs in Nice because Bob and I live out there. Mm-hmm. But the rest of the time was just really getting the new album away. So I just can't stop writing albums. I've got to slow down. So and it's very difficult to get all the guys together because they all live all over the world. So it's it's done in bitty sections. So that kind of slowed it down a bit. But it's out now. So we've got it. It's done. It's out. It's been released this week. And hopefully that gets some interest.
Absolutely. So it's called The Secret. And it's not a secret anymore, but I suppose one of the secrets is that it does actually feature the guitar legend Peter Banks. So the last track on the album, which is called The Secret, has got Peter on it. So exactly how was that achieved?
Well, that was it was achieved because Dan Earnshaw had... I think he approached Bob and said that we had some tracks of Peter Banks and would you like to do anything with it? So Bob called me and we said, okay, well, let's hear what it is. And I'd love to do something with it.
Yeah.
So we were sent over some clips of what he'd recorded a while back, obviously. But there were just a few. They're not as many as I thought. So we sort of took a couple of them and we thought, I can't write a song around that.
Yeah.
But the only way to do it is to, because I think Dan at one point said, can you write, create a song around it? And I thought, I'd be delighted to do that. But there wasn't enough on the clip. So we thought, no, I can't write a song around it, but I could certainly put it in a song. Mm. I was working on this weird piano piece, which starts The Secret, and it's quite an interesting piano piece, and I was sort of knocking that out at home on my Bechstein, and I thought, hang on, it could go in there, but of course different key, different different rhythm, everything. So with Max Hunt, who's on the keyboards and produced The Secret, this album, we thought, well, let's see what we can do. So we kind of changed it around a bit, and lo and behold, we could drop it into this song we're working on called The Secret. It wasn't called The Secret, it was just a song at that point. And we played around with it and we sort of wrote some music for the middle section where it came in. And then it all sort of, we just thought, hang on, we can repeat this, some of his phrases again and again. So we did, and we played around with them, chopped around a bit, but it worked really well. So then we thought, hang on, well, this is a secret because so let's call the song The Secret. Let's call the whole album The Secret while we're at it. And that's how it came about. Yeah. And in the end, it worked out quite well.
I think. Yeah, it's a very interesting song indeed. It's got some slightly sort of disconcerting tonalities in there with the Peter Banks guitar, but it's also got a catchy refrain, hasn't it? So it works as a very interesting sort of trippy type song, I think.
I love the discordant thing. I mean, I'm quite into my Persian music and Indian music, and the whole idea of discordant, I love it. It just makes it so. And what we were doing years ago is that. So I thought it just fits perfectly. And there's a couple of bits where you think, oh, and then you think, no, it does work. But at first, it's like, hang on, what are they doing?
Yeah, I did enjoy listening to it. So take us back to your work with Peter then, all those years ago. And obviously, Yes are coming up for their 50th anniversary very soon, and you were working with him before that. What was it like working with him? I mean, he appeared to be, very much larger than life when you see him on those old black and white recordings of him. He seems to be, on a different plane. Was it like that?
I think it was funny because at the time, I think Peter thought I was a terrible guitarist, and I think he thought he was a really good. And truthfully, he was a lot better guitarist than I was.
Yeah.
So he had a decent guitar as well, which is great. So it was fun because Bob and I were playing lots of psychedelic stuff with Mabel Greer, and then Chris came in, and then Peter Banks. So he was used to, you know, slightly different music, and it was great because there was a real sort of chemical friction between what are you doing and what he was doing, and it was great fun. I think it was really good. I think it was a sort of merge of different outlooks. We were far more psychedelic. I mean, my thing, well, it wasn't my motto, but my thing was I don't think I ever played the same phrase twice. You know, I'd just ad lib and play how I felt, where Peter was really far more structured. So it was good fun. Yeah. Great.
Yeah, so you say he was far more structured, and I can understand that, but did he do a lot of improvising as well, though? I mean, he may have been quite structured in his approach, but certainly on those early Yes tracks.
Yeah, but he did improvise. I mean, a classic would be Midnight Sleigh Ride theme, nice, that he put in, you know, da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
Yes.
And so, well, you probably know. But so he would play it as it should be. If I played that, I'd change it. I'd you know, so he was... He would ad lib and put stuff in, but he would be more accurate and more consistent. And he did ad lib as well, but I think that was me saying, "Come on, let's play it differently tonight." You know? No, let's play it like we said we'll play it. No, I had that with the band a lot. It was like, for God's sake, Clive, can you play what we said you'd play? I was like, yeah, it doesn't feel right tonight.
Okay, well, tell us about the other songs on the album. Was there a sort of unifying theme there? There's quite a bit of different stuff on there.
I think really, no, it's just a collection of stuff that I've been working on over the last year, and some of it I composed on the piano and then transposed it to guitar, and so there's sort of a lot of ballads in there. Wanted to bring classical music in though, so you got Swan Lake on Swan, and I was listening to Swan Lake, sort of, and I heard, you know, I think, oh, that would be so great on a wild electric guitar. I thought, wow, let's put it into a theme. And then I thought with Swan, okay, well, you know, Russian, so let's have the sound of a Russian choir in there, mm-hmm. like moody for the steps, and then, okay, and let's rock the guitar out a bit, and then let's put a bit of Beethoven in there for, you know, or something like that. So it's a sort of mixing music together. I like fusion. I like, you know, mixing Indian, Persian, classic, rock, making it all meld, I think. And then the lyrics are a little bit mystical and a bit sort of strong, if you like. Yeah. Just to sort of hold it together, but it's just what came out. I don't really know why. I can't really say that the intention was to make the songs like that. You know, when you're songwriting, they just pop out really, and you go with it, and then it builds, and you alter it, and you know, add and take away. So I can't say there was a particular mood or feel to get across. It is what it is, sort of thing. I have to think about that. I don't know, probably.
Well, the Swan that you've mentioned is an interesting one there. So you say it's got some classical influences in there with Swan Lake and so on, but it's also got some pretty prog-sounding keyboards. So something sounds a bit like a Mini Moog and a Hammond in there. So there's a whole lot in that one song.
Well, you're right. So Max, who does the piano, he's in a tribute band, Fragile. So he's quite used to playing Yes and Genesis kind of things. And I've always liked Yes, obviously, and Genesis. So it was, why don't we pop in and why don't we get some sounds that we, you know, used to doing. So, yeah, we did have some sort of Hammond and Moog stuff in there, which was interesting. You're right. I'm glad you heard it.
Yeah.
I'm glad it came out.
But then in other songs, you go a very different way. As you've already said, it's a bit of a melting pot. But tell us about Big Brother, Little Brother. Is that Native American sort of chants and so on in there?
That's right. So it's a political commentary, really, isn't it, on Native American Indians. And it's quite strong. The lyrics are very strong on that. And but I was playing around with that. There's a clip of us in the studio in Paris, I think, where we just mucked around with it. But you're right, they're chancing it. So I thought, well, if we're going to do it, let's go the whole hog. And we thought, well, let's get some Native American Indian chants. And I couldn't find any. So, oh, we'll do it ourselves. So, you know, it could have been corny, but it's not. So we did some chanting, and the chanting was completely out of rhythm to the music on purpose. So the whole Native American thing is it's like the discordant thing. Let's have someone chanting in the background a completely different way to where the music's going, which is kind of how it would be if you were out there at that time with those people. So, yeah, I recorded some chants, went way out there, way out of my head chanting. And then we dropped that in as a sort of background, and we changed the rhythm halfway through the song to incorporate that. That's why it suddenly slows down, which actually works very well. It's powerful. But that came about because the chanting was in different rhythm, different key, different everything.
So another song that I enjoyed, Turning to the Light, and that's got some echoes of sort of Mellotron and 1960s feel. Was that one of the ones which was a bit more looking back to those psychedelic eras?
That came... So Max was doing a guitar riff, and I thought, hang on, that riff is good. Let's work around that. And that, again, that evolved. First, it was just the guitar, which started, and then just completely ad-libbed and put a song around it. Came up with the lyrics spontaneously, probably changed them a tiny bit, but it was purely, that was an in the moment, let's just play. And that sort of popped out. So it wasn't, again, by design, it was by default. It just popped out, which a lot happens with a lot of the songs. And then having got the elements there, then we recorded it again and again and overlaid stuff on it. And that was definitely building up in the moment one. We got together in Cannes and put that down with Bob and Hugo on bass.
Yeah.
And then back to the studio again and adding bits and taking bits out. And that was definitely just evolved.
Yeah, so it's interesting. I've talked to various people recently about the way they put songs together. So you say it's difficult to get people together. And what do you think of the trend? And I know you worked with Billy Sherwood, I think, on the previous album. What do you think of the process of sending away tracks for other people to add their parts to and then receiving them back and mixing them and so on? Or do you prefer, if possible, to get into the same room?
It's better to all be together because you'll get more, well, you could say you get more feeling, but because we've had to do it this way, so we're getting used to sending tracks off to someone and getting it back and doing that. And for me, at the end of the day, it's all about the arrangement. So you do that, but then the final thing is on the arrangement. Okay, what are you going to put in and what are you going to take out of the song? And do you lose that in the moment recording studio or together energy or feel if you do it that way, where, you know, you're sending tracks off and getting them back? And I think we've been lucky. I think because we've had to do it this way, you know, I was a bit nervous. Oh, it'll be much better to all get together. But on the other hand, you can arrange some pretty interesting stuff when you do it the way we did it. And I'm happy that it's turned out well. I guess you could easily argue it'd be much better to all be together and build it up that way. But, you know, the way the world's going, that gets harder and harder.
Yeah, so tell me a bit about that, because I know that a lot of bands are now, you know, spending an awful lot of time on the road because that's the way they can, well, make some money. And studio time seems to be getting more and more expensive. Is that really the case, or can things not be done, you know, on a much, much more of a shoestring nowadays with all the digital techniques that are out there?
I think they can be. So we had the songs and we went into the studio all together. But then, you know, as long as you link the sort of drums and bass up fairly well, you can then go back to a bedroom studio, strip it all out and add in what you need to add in. And then, you know, as long as you've got a vocal booth or sound which is okay and some decent microphones, you can actually create something quite strong, quite orchestral. So I don't know, I'm sure a lot of people more and more will do the sort of, you know, record it in their room as opposed to having to be in a studio. You do need some of it in the studio, I think, to lock it in better. But we did one big session in Cannes for 3 days, and it was definitely taking stuff out, putting it back in. Oh, Hugo, you know, can we change that bass part? Why don't we change it like this? Okay, we'll send you the file, you send it back. We didn't quite like that on the drums, Bob. Could you change that? Yeah. So I think you get the basis down in the studio, and then you can alter it by remote and come up with something quite interesting.
Yeah, yeah. So tell us about production then. You must have worked with some actual producers in the past. Is that something you like to do? Do you like to have someone who's outside the project, outside the band, helping you along in the studio or with the recordings? Or do you prefer to do things on your own nowadays?
Well, I get on very well with Max, who produced this on and plays the keyboards in the band. So when it comes to sort of, you know, programs to actually do the arrangement, I mean, I can do it, but I get very frustrated with it. I'm a very much now person, in the moment, do it now. Oh, I can't work out which button to press. Oh, no, you know, I'll delete everything by mistake. I've done that. We did that on the first half. We've just deleted 1-2 weeks work. You know. So Max is pretty good. And I love arranging. I really love arranging. And my trouble is I tend to throw too much in there. So let's put this in, let's put this in, let's put that in. Working with Max on producing it was great because I didn't actually have to say the whole sentence. He knew where my head was musically. So I think you have to work with someone who's on your wavelength, which he is. I just love arranging. So it works. I think if you can hear the sound in your head, then you can say, you know, why don't we try that? And then you can play around with it and put some counterpoint in and not, and then look at it again and start stripping it out because you've got 28 tracks and you only really want 8 or something. So, yeah, I like working with someone who can do the technical side, and I just love arranging. I mean, I could spend my whole life arranging. That would be brilliant.
Yeah. Great. Okay, well, the Secret is a great record. I really enjoyed listening to it.
Oh,
and
you.
I think we're going to have a copy of it to give away on the show, which will be lovely.
Great. Thank you.
Just to finish off with, though, as we said, next year is the 50th anniversary of Yes, of course, and Mabel Greer's Toy Shop are definitely a part of the story. I mean, that was what Yes grew out of in the first place. Do you still feel part of the sort of legacy of Yes?
Well, definitely part of the legacy because, dare I say it, we did sort of, you know, originate it by Bob and I, first with Chris coming in and then Peter and then John and then Bill Bruford. So, we feel we're part of the legacy. Obviously, they moved it on because that was 50 years ago. I should have moved it.
Yeah.
I feel part of it very much. It was our baby, you know, to start with. I mean, I have created a few things in my life, but that's one I like to mention. so it was good. Yeah, definitely feel part of it.
That's great. Are you going to be able to get to any of the celebrations for the 50th anniversary?
Well, hopefully. I mean, I live in Nice and I work in London, so we definitely will. I don't know which ones. We're going to do some gigs ourselves next year. There's talk of us doing a few in the States, and we're going to put a showcase gig on in London finally next year. So, you know, anyone that likes Yes, if they want to come along, check out our website. And we'd love to do that because I think both Bob and I want to get back into music a lot more. So,
great. Well, you've got two very successful albums.
Thank you.
And thank you very much indeed for speaking to us today.
My pleasure. Thanks so much. Thank you.
Hi, this is Lee Pomeroy, and you're listening to the Yes Music Podcast.
As I mentioned in the interview, I have a copy of The Secret to give away. If you'd like to receive it, just send an email to show@yesmusicpodcast.com with the answer to this question. Name 4 members of Yes who joined Mabel Greer's Toy Shop before they changed the name to Yes. Good luck.
Greetings, friends.